Danielle Berry Johnson.
And I'm Joshua Marshall.
And we're students at Conwell-Egan Catholic High School in Fairless Hills.
Fairless Hills is midway between Philadelphia and Trenton, New Jersey, and one of the main highways in the American Revolution.
Just a few miles southeast of here is the little borough of Bristol. There, another very secret revolution took place, known as the Underground Railroad.
Now let's take a walk to the Underground Railroad and witness the history in our front yards.
Bristol Borough is a small town outside of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Having been founded in 1681, Bristol has witnessed our nation's history in its entirety. Bristol is also home to the African American Historical and Cultural Society, an organization which has worked to bring the role of African Americans have played in our nation's history to light. Mayor Joseph Saxon of Bristol has also played a large role in our town's dedication to its citizens and its history over the past few years.
Here we are on Radcliffe. This street runs of Bristol parallels the Delaware River.
Radcliffe Street is also where the Underground Railroad ran.
These homes were owned by the Pierce family.
They were Quakers who were very involved in abolitionist movement.
Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Joe Saxton. I have the privilege of being the mayor of a little town called Bristol Borough, which is located in Bucks County, Pennsylvania, approximately about 25 miles outside of Philadelphia. It's a historic town founded in 1681 on a grant from William Penn by a gentleman by the name of Samuel Cliff, who was given a charter and 262 acres to form what we now know today as historic Bristol Borough. From there, just giving a little bit of history about the town, the challenge at that time, as you can imagine, back in the 1600s, not having all the conveniences that we have today, was the constructing of a town. And Bristol became very quickly known as a center between Philadelphia and what was called Morrisville. And Bristol was like a stop-off point for a lot of people traveling between Philadelphia, Morrisville, New York. So that's how Bristol basically got on the map and then its close proximity to Philadelphia. So we enjoy our history. We're on the National Historic Registry. Some of the places that we have in town are National Historic buildings. Later on, I'd say probably, I guess in the 60s, maybe even the 70s, 1970s, began to surface this story about Harriet Ross Tubman. And the Ross family is a Bristolian family, which Mr. Taylor, I believe, is a relative of. And that's where I began to hear it. I mean, later on, as I got involved in politics, and then as I got involved with some of the historical societies, one being the Bucks County African American Historical Society, as well as the Bristol Borough Cultural Historical Society, Harriet Tubman's efforts began to surface, and I began to read a little bit more about, her achievements, and was really astounded by what she was able to accomplish. And going forward, I had the opportunity to, as the mayor, as a councilman, and as a mayor, to work along with Sid Taylor and the Bucks County African American Historical Group to move the statue and the building of the statue forward. So I feel pretty good about that. Well, within our town, we have along the Delaware River, we have what we call Lions Park. It's actually a quaint little passive area where we have constructed over the last 15, 20 years now a couple different monuments. When I say we, individual ethnic groups, an Italian group got together and put up a monument to Christopher Columbus. The Celtic group got together and put up a monument celebrating Celtic heritage. The Puerto Rican group put together a monument celebrating Puerto Rican Latino. The only thing that was missing at this point was something from the African American community, which had, over the years, been working on some type of monument, and I think that when they finalized and decided to to pick Harriet Tubman as the monument. I thought it was an excellent idea because it really, it's all about what Bristol is about. It's again, this collection of different ethnic groups having lived together forever with little or no problems. I mean, we just don't see color. I guess, at least I don't. I think the majority of the people in our town don't look at people either through their ethnicity or through their color. You're a Bristolian. So I think as each monument was built, people began to find out about the history of that group and what they were doing and the purpose of the statue. Same thing with the Harriet Ross Tubman statue, was that I think people are very proud of that addition. They put that in June of 2006, I believe, is when it went in. And, I mean, it was a massive show of sport. You know, I think we were over 1,000 people that showed up that day in the rain in the beginning for the unveiling of the statue. So, yeah, I think people view it as another piece of the history of the town, and they accept that. I mean, I consider myself someone who, you know, would support 100% what Harriet Tubman stands for, which I think is equality and fairness for everybody, and that, you know, that someone should never be forced into being an indentured slave for anything. I try to live not the life that she lived, but support what she believed in, and that's why I was very happy to be a part of the ceremony when we dedicated the statue.
As Bristol Borough is such an historic place, its townspeople have been fascinated with its history for generations. The Margaret R. Grundy Memorial Library plays a large role in history keeping, as Mr. and Mrs. Harold Michener volunteer their time to research and record the history of Bristol Borough. This history at times may involve the Underground Railroad and Harriet Tubman herself.
In Bristol, we know that there were three houses that were definitely part of the Underground Railroad. I'm basing this on a history book of Bristol written by Doran Green, and Doran Green mentions these three houses. The first house is at 315 Radcliffe Street. This house had been built in 1847 by a Quaker Charles W. Pierce. This house had a secret hiding place up under the roof in a small little chamber. The house itself has a cupola on top, which was there for ventilation during the summer, and it was under here that the slaves were hidden. This house is on Radcliffe Street, which is a street right along the Delaware River. A second house we had was the house built by the Charles W. Pierce, and this was built about 1856 after the Fugitive Slave Law was passed, and it's located at 431 Radcliffe Street. And this house was a stop on the Underground Railroad. Slaves were notified that these houses were safe because they were led mostly by people who were abolitionists, who were part of the Underground Railroad movement. So they would be led from point A to point B by someone, and then when they got to point B, they would be led to point C by someone else. Example, when they went across the Delaware River to Burlington or to Bordentown, they would have been rowed across at night in someone's small boat, and then they would have been met on the opposite side, and then that person from Bristol would have come back across the river, as far as we know. I have been told that the Tubman family was connected to Bristol because Harriet Ross Tubman was her name, and we have Ross families in Bristol who came from Maryland, where Harriet came from, and they knew they were related to her. And then the Davis family, one of the Davis families, a Taylor family, and probably a couple of others. There are some people who are members of the African American Cultural and Historical Society in Bristol, and they are directly descended from Harriet Tubman. This has been known in their families for many years. Now, Harriet Tubman married a second time. She married a Mr. Davis, but Harriet, we don't ever know if she were in Bristol, or if she was in Bristol, but we don't think so. There's no record of that. And one time Harriet went down into Maryland, I think it was to bring up her grandfather, or her father, and she went by train. Just bought a ticket and went on the train. So there were slaves on incognito going on some train. And the monument of Harriet Tubman is that she was a leader of the Underground Railroad. She was known as the Moses of her people. And so consequently, because there are people in the African American society here in Lower Bucks County, Bristol, as part of that, that are directly related to her, they pushed to have a monument of Harriet, and that monument of Harriet points to the North Star. She's pointing in that direction.
On March 10, 2003, this beautiful statue and monument of Harriet Ross Tubman was unveiled. The Bristol Borough Council made a resolution supporting the African American Historical and Cultural Society's project to erect the Harriet Ross Tubman Monument to honor this extraordinary woman who conducted the railroad to freedom. Harriet Tubman is a national icon for this movement. She's a symbol of courage and bravery to remind people of all ages that the impossible is possible, and to recognize the efforts of all people to strive for individual freedom and against repression.
The African American Cultural and Historical Society has played a large role over the years in enlightening Bristol citizens on the role African Americans have played in our nation's history. Sidney Taylor, a descendant of Harriet Tubman and member of the African American Cultural and Historical Society, played an instrumental role in the dedication of Harriet Tubman Monument in Bristol Borough. Without his tireless efforts, the symbol of hope would not stand before this small town.
Why did people want to know so much about Harriet? It wasn't necessarily the battle she went into, it was the courage that she had. It was a fortitude that she has. And this is the important thing for it. It will make you a better person knowing about her, because you'll say, if she could do it, couldn't read and write, very short in stature, why can't I do what she did? Big difference? You have to have heart. No heart, you can't do the things that she did. You have to be unselfish in what you're doing. And what is more, and this is where I come in, you so to speak, my family, this is the Rosses. I asked my uncle once, he's Ross, this is Sam Ross, and we were doing an interview, something like this, and I asked him about a question about how I think or how he is, and he says his father said, he's told him, he says, never be late and never disappoint anyone. It's a little bit more with Harriet Tubman than just water. I thought relatives, it really didn't matter at one particular time. But I did come to believe and to know it really is a bloodline, and you do inherit traits. You inherit many, many things. You inherit things from your mother, your father, and your grandfather, and your great-grandfather. And it makes you what you are today. And so, we have courage. We stand up for what is right, because it's what we do. And you say, why did this little short black lady have this much influence with them? And she didn't have all these feats when she first met them. They kept growing as they were. But they admired her determination, and they admired her wisdom when she was speaking. And this is one of the reasons why they helped her. For instance, he said about Abraham Lincoln one time, this is dealing with the war, and she said, in other words, when a snake strikes you, you can't just patch up the wound, and then he strikes again, patch up the wound, and he strikes again, and she was referring to the Civil War, and fix it up again. She says, Yaha, that killed the snake. And then you can prevent the whole thing. So she had that type of wisdom, which allowed a lot of people to want to talk to her, and why she was so influential with these people. When she hit Pennsylvania, and she looked, saw the sun shining down on her, and could feel the ground, and know that this was free. And she was a very, very happy individual. In order to have that opportunity to be free, and greater than that, to understand that she, up after that, she would be able to go back and help so many. And she loved her parents, and she made it her point to bring out her parents, and she made it her point to bring out her her brothers and her sisters, because some of them were already sold into the Deep South, which meant never to see them again. So in that respect, she was courageous, thinking about family, just like today we should think about family, and not so much about ourselves, and think about others too. Well, freedom was one of the main things. You know what freedom is. You've always been free. And I don't even think that you can have a concept in your mind what it means to be a slave and not be free. Told when you can get up, told when you can go to bed, told when you can eat. No original ideas on your own in that kind of society because you are a slave. So everything you have almost is taken away from you. Now, the reason for that is because they want to make you a non-person. And if they can make you a non-person, then they can work you like a mule. Somebody that just generally they should look to. When they kind of lose their way, and you're thinking, well, who can I emulate? They can say, I would like to emulate Harriet Tubman. Just look at her, read about her, and seeing where she was not selfish with what she had. She had the conviction to do what she wanted to do. She wasn't afraid about things that might cause her a death in what she was doing. She understood that there was a greater cause than just her. It was a cause that she was doing for all people that looked like her, and also for people who didn't look like her. Because I can add this, without good Caucasians helping Harriet along the way, there's no way that she can make all these trips from the south to the north without a lot of good people, and in particular, Quakers that helped. So it took a community of people in the Underground Railroad in order to get to where you wanted to go. It's an honor to have a cousin like that, but it's also good to be able, and I'm in the position to now, to tell others about her and how to get ahead. We, at this particular time, have a new president, President-elect. Nobody would ever thought this possible, but never could any of this happen if there wasn't a Harriet Tubman that came before this.
No, I was a slave. I don't know whether you know what a slave means. If somebody was old,
Davis is a cousin of Sidney Taylor and relative of Harriet Tubman. Miss Davis performs a reenactment of Harriet Tubman's life for local schools to raise awareness of this influential woman and to teach children that all people have the right to freedom. and the opportunity to fight to obtain it.
It's hard to separate because I think that most people don't realize the degree of danger. There were always patrollers out looking for runaway slaves. She came into an area that people knew her, back to Maryland, where she could be recognized. And she always managed to make sure that she diverted their attention or got into some kind of disguise and never got caught. But I think that all the things that she did were so dangerous. The miracle is that she got through any of them. And one time when she went on a train, the conductor and some other people who operated the train assaulted her and put her in the baggage car and I think broke some of her bones. But I think that this was just the course it would take because they didn't want to deal with blacks in the way that they should have dealt with. I think it was that she didn't want her family to be enslaved. She had experienced it. She not only experienced her family being mistreated, her sisters and her brothers being sold away, she also witnessed when a slave on the plantation would be chastised for doing something that they shouldn't do, like trying to run away. She also heard about the different slave uprisings and so was inspired by the fact that the slaves, contrary to what people wanted to spread around, that they were not willing to stay in that situation. Well, that she was a real person, that she was faced with problems that were, even at that time, thought to be insurmountable. And she, with help from a lot of other people, not by herself, but she just continued onward and didn't disregard the problem. She didn't disregard the difficulty. She just overrode it, used her intelligence and the connections that she had in order to not dismiss the dangers, but to override them. I think that it's to be able to make your own decisions, to be able to have your family around you if that's what you wanted, not to be directed by someone else about what you had to do, to be able mostly to make your own decisions and take the consequences of your decisions, not somebody else's. I think because she operated in so many different areas, not just freeing slaves, but as an abolitionist and women's rights, that she was responding to the problems that were historically present then, and she operated to, bring about some sense of equality and that blacks were as much human beings as anyone else, and also to clarify the meanings that are coming from both the Bible and the Constitution. Yes. I think she felt that people were distorting the meanings rather than following them truly. And because she felt she had direct contact with God, she was convinced that the directions that she took were justified.
Harriet Tubman was a phenomenal woman. This documentary just scratches the surface on how amazing she truly was.
Her longing for freedom and her desire for change inspired a domino effect in America's history, with African-American leaders such as Martin Luther King Jr., Rosa Parks, and our 2009 president, Barack Obama.
Yes, Josh. And it's hard to believe that significant events related to Harriet Tubman's life and work happened not too far from our own front yard.